Irritable bowel syndrome is a chronic functional disorder. It's the most common disorder of the GI tract. And irritable bowel syndrome has a few cardinal symptoms. The major symptom of irritable bowel syndrome is abdominal pain. Basically, if abdominal pain is absent, it's not irritable bowel syndrome. Abdominal pain usually is triggered or relieved by defecation. The second feature of irritable bowel syndrome is change in stool frequency. It can be diarrhea or constipation. And usually, with diarrhea, stool becomes watery, and with constipation, stool becomes hard. So the third criteria is change in stool appearance. So the central symptom of irritable bowel syndrome is abdominal pain, and everything else are minor symptoms. What is the most important to understand is that irritable bowel syndrome is a functional disorder, which means that there is no detectable structural or laboratory abnormalities. Every diagnostic method that you prescribe is normal, but abdominal pain with the minor symptoms are still present. According to current criteria, irritable bowel syndrome is broken down into different subgroups based on predominant stool consistency. The first one is diarrhea predominant. If the digestive system contracts quicker than normal, this results in diarrhea. The second type is constipation predominant. Occurs if intestine contracts slowly. Low rate of contraction results in constipation. Also, we have a mixed type, which is basically when diarrhea is changed by constipation and then again diarrhea occurs, and unclassified type. Important that irritable bowel syndrome do not increase the risk of cancer or Crohn's disease, but it can greatly affect the quality of life. So, which factors can provoke irritable bowel syndrome? First of all, it's genetic factors, as hypersensitivity of receptors. Also, it's physical and emotional stress, acute infections or inflammation of the intestine, and antibiotics used. So initially, at the moment of birth, person can have some genetic predisposition to irritable bowel syndrome. For example, he has hypersensitivity of receptors. But just genetic predisposition is not enough to trigger the disease. Then at 15 years old, he has some emotional stress. If stress is really severe, it can trigger irritable bowel syndrome straight away. But usually, it's also not enough. And at 22 years old, he has inflammation of the colon, provoked by bacterial infection. And now, the combination of three factors triggers irritable bowel syndrome. And because it's a chronic disorder, most likely it will be with person for the rest of his life. Also, we have to know that irritable bowel syndrome has strong association with sleep disturbances, fibromyalgia, back pain, chronic pelvic pain, anxiety and depression. It can help us in diagnosis because if person has one of these disorders, the probability of irritable bowel syndrome greatly increase. Nowadays, to make a diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome, we use ROM4 criteria. According to this criteria, recurrent abdominal pain is essential for irritable bowel syndrome. So if abdominal pain is absent, it's not irritable bowel syndrome. Abdominal pain is associated with three features. First of all, abdominal pain is related to defecation. Defecation can relieve pain or it can worsen pain, it can be both. Also, together with pain, person should have change in stool frequency. Basically, it can be constipation, diarrhea or both. And the third criteria is change in form of stool. In constipation, stool becomes hard, and in diarrhea, stool becomes watery. Probably the major criteria is absence of alarm symptoms. So everything which tells us about cancer, bleeding and inflammation should be absent. If any of the alarm symptoms are present, we cannot make a diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome. In this case, we should search for organic pathology. So to make a diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome, we should exclude every other disease that has similar symptoms. We call this a diagnosis of exclusion, which means that any diagnostic test that you prescribe is normal. Complete blood count is normal, endoscopy shows normal mucosa. Iron deficiency markers are also normal, and everything else should be normal. But the abdominal pain and change in stool frequency are present. We call this functional disorder, means that bowel doesn't function properly, but there is no detectable structural damage. So, if we have to determine the major features of irritable bowel syndrome, it will be abdominal pain and normal diagnostic test, with absence of the alarm symptoms. It's the features that make this disorder functional. So, in irritable bowel syndrome, abdominal pain is the major symptom. And the reason why abdominal pain occurs is genetic hypersensitivity of receptors. To explain this, here we have intestinal lumen, mucous membrane of the intestine, and also intestine has nociceptive receptor. When chyme enters into the intestine, chyme causes distension of intestinal wall. Distension causes stimulation of nociceptive receptor. And nociceptive receptor sees distension as electric impulse. But because stimulation is not strong enough, impulse do not reach a threshold of excitation, and thereby it do not cause depolarization. No depolarization, no pain. But what happens in person with irritable bowel syndrome? The amount of food that enters into the intestine is the same. The difference is in the location of the receptor. In person with irritable bowel syndrome, usually, receptor is located more superficially. So now, even if food causes the same distension of the intestinal wall, the stimulation of the receptor is much stronger, simply because receptor is located more superficially. The stronger is the stimulation, the stronger is the electric impulse. So now distension of the intestinal wall causes electric impulse that reach a threshold of excitation. And if impulse reach a threshold, it causes depolarization. And depolarization of the receptor causes pain. So in case of irritable bowel syndrome, receptors are located more superficially. And it's a major difference between people with normal intestinal sensitivity and people with hypersensitivity. The second group of symptoms are related to motility. Motility can be increased and this causes diarrhea, or decreased and this causes constipation. To explain how motility becomes affected, here we have large intestine. Intestine has receptors on a mucous membrane. Also, there is brain as a part of central nervous system, and also there is smooth muscle cells of the intestine. So when food with water enters into the intestine, income of food is sensed by intestinal receptors, that in response to food carries a signal by afferent neural fibers that organism need to increase parasympathetic nervous system activity. Organ that regulates the balance between parasympathetic nervous system and sympathetic nervous system is brain. In response to signal, brain stimulates parasympathetic nervous system and inhibits sympathetic nervous system. So now afferent fibers carry the signal to smooth muscle cells of the intestine, and this signal tells that now parasympathetic nervous system is on the driving seat. In response to parasympathetic stimulation, intestine increases contractility of smooth muscle cells. So let's suppose that now intestine will work at a speed of 3 contractions per minute, which is optimal space. This regulation called gut-brain axis. So in normal condition, in response to food, large intestine begin to move at rate of 3 contractions per minute. Let's suppose that the length of the large intestine is 30, so it gives the time of intestinal transit 10. So now intestine has 10 minutes to absorb sufficient amount of water. So step by step, in 10 minutes, colon absorb the optimal amount of water. As a result, with defecation, person will have normal stool. But we have a few factors that can affect motility of the large intestine. And they can affect in both ways. So every factor can increase motility or decrease motility. It all depends on individual factors. So the first factor is genetic sensitivity of the receptor. It's the same factor that causes pain. It can be hypersensitivity that will cause increase in motility, so diarrhea will develop. Or it can be hypersensitivity that will cause decrease in motility, as a result constipation will develop. And the second factor is emotional stress, that also can cause increase or decrease in bowel movements. To explain this, let's suppose that person experiences severe anxiety, psychological trauma or depression. All these conditions can disrupt the processing of information by the brain. In stress, brain cannot function as precise as it should be, and this can cause parasympathetic-sympathetic neural system disbalance. So, for example, instead of moderate stimulation of parasympathetic nervous system and moderate inhibition of sympathetic nervous system, now in stress, brain causes overstimulation of parasympathetic nervous system and overinhibition of sympathetic nervous system. As a result, efferent signal carries significantly stronger stimulation to smooth muscle cells. In response to this, motility increases. So now, instead of 3 contractions per minute, intestine makes 6 contractions per minute, and this causes diarrhea. To explain this, now intestine contracts in rate of 6 contractions per minute, which is basically speed. The length is the same, 30, and length divided on speed is intestinal transition time. In this case, it's 5 minutes instead of normal 10. The problem is that it's too fast for intestine to absorb all water. In 5 minutes, colon can absorb only a minor portion. So the larger portion of water will be excreted with stool, and increase in water concentration in the stool causes loose stool. So as we see, watery or loose stool is the feature of diarrhea, and we call this condition irritable bowel syndrome, diarrhea predominant. Now, let's suppose that sensitivity of receptor is genetically lower than normal. So when food enters into the intestine, because receptors are hypersensitive, they will send less potent signal to the brain, and such signal will not provide sufficient stimulation of parasympathetic nervous system. As a result, brain will provide only mild increase in parasympathetic nervous system and mild inhibition of sympathetic nervous system, which is not enough. In this case, efferent neurons will cause insufficient stimulation of smooth muscle cells. As a result, the rate of intestinal contractions will be lower than normal, and we call this state constipation. So now intestine makes only 1 contraction per minute. The length of intestine is the same, and in this case, intestinal transit will take 30 minutes. So now, instead of 10 minutes for absorption, intestine will have 30 minutes, which is a significant difference. In 30 minutes, step by step, intestine will absorb all available water. And feces with low concentration of water we call hard stool or dry stool. And we call this condition irritable bowel syndrome, constipation predominant. The third mechanism is related to post-infectional changes. Inflammation can disrupt neuromuscular signaling. So after the severe infection of the colon, sometimes neuromuscular signaling can be disrupted. In this case, smooth muscle cells cannot adequately receive impulses from efferent neurons. So for example, in response to moderate stimulation, smooth muscle cells hyperreact, and instead of 3 contractions, they begin to contract at a rate of 6 contractions per minute. And this will cause diarrhea with watery stool. So we have 3 most common factors that can affect gut-brain axis. First of all, it's genetic factors that most commonly are related to receptor. So in this case, receptor cannot adequately receive information. Also, it's central nervous system factors, as an anxiety or depression. Factors that cause emotional stress are the most common, and they affect the capacity of brain to receive and process signal, which is absolutely essential. And the third group affects the state of smooth muscle cells of the colon. The most common factor is post-infectional changes. All these factors disrupt different links in the gut-brain axis, but they all affect the contractility of intestine. if person has a combination of these factors, as emotional stress and genetic predisposition, in this case, irritable bowel syndrome will develop even more likely. Also, all these factors do not cause detectable morphological damage. So any pathological changes on endoscopy or histological changes will be absent. And every diagnostic method will be normal. So intestine is intact, but contractility is disrupted. It's the reason why we call irritable bowel syndrome functional disorder. So person has pain and changes in motility, but we cannot detect any morphological damage. So organic cause is absent and it's absolutely essential for the diagnosis. Because if organic cause is present, it's not irritable bowel syndrome. The first option in treatment is proper diet. Nowadays, we have three major diets. The first one is fiber-rich diet, which is most effective in constipation. The second diet is low FODMAP diet. Basically, in this diet, we exclude non-digestible carbohydrates, which are poorly absorbed in the small bowel. And the third diet is most common gluten-free diet. To relieve pain in irritable bowel syndrome, we use antispasmodic drugs and peppermint oil. Dicyclamine and peppermint oil cause relaxation of the smooth muscle cells in the intestinal wall. This causes decrease in abdominal wall pressure, and thereby it decreases stimulation of receptor. So now the impulse that generates receptor do not reach a threshold of excitation, and thereby there will be no depolarization. And no depolarization, no pain. In case of constipation, we use lubiprostone and linaclotide. They both increase intestinal secretion. So basically, lubiprostone and linaclotide, by increasing intestinal secretion, they increase intestinal motility. And with increasing motility, we reverse constipation into the normal state. So, lubiprostone and linaclotide we use in constipation. The next drugs are serotonin receptor antagonists. It's alacetrone and ondansetron. They decrease motility of the intestine, and because of this, we use them in diarrhea. So, ondansetron and alacetrone, by decreasing motility, they reverse diarrhea into the normal state, and normal motility will result in normal stool. The next group of drugs are opioid receptor antagonists. It's eloxadoline and loperamide, also known as Imodium. By blockage of opioid receptor, they decrease the severity of pain. So both eloxadoline and loperamide, they decrease the activity of opioid receptors. And now receptor will produce significantly lower electric impulse that will not reach a threshold of excitation. Thereby, there will be no depolarization. No depolarization, no pain. Rifaximin is a gastrointestinal selective antibiotic. So initially, you give rifaximin, and by this you eliminate bacterial overgrowth, and then you give probiotics to correct gut microbiota. Because one of the theories is that bacteria in the intestine can also provoke changes in intestinal motility. Also, as a reserve option, we can use tricyclic antidepressants. They also can decrease the severity of pain. Generally, they also decrease the magnitude of electric impulse, so electric impulse will not reach a threshold of excitation, no depolarization, no pain. Also, we have to remember that we give tricyclic antidepressants before bed, because otherwise the patient will look like this.